It's so funny because, like, the guys who created the book, they're, like, super into it. So I'm like, they're cool. Like, it's okay. Well, that's still watch. But if you're coming, I mean, we've all done that. We've all read books and then gone to see the movie. And, like, I always flipped the table after I saw Lovely Bones. I was like, what? You know, like, I could, which I shouldn't say, but I did. But we all have had that experience. And so, but we just knew what would work for television, and it's inspired by it. Like, we wouldn't exist if that didn't exist, so it was definitely inspired, but it was more thinking about what would work on a week-to-week basis for television. Hi. I was talking about how nice you smell.
Oh, I feel like I smell like
no, you smell good. They asked if you were smelly for something.
That seems like an odd. It was.
Yeah. But I told them that you always.
We were going to gossip. It was gossip.
Rob Thomas has a reputation of smelling. Can you confirm?
I'm going to go.
I deny. I deny.
Smell at a Comic Con is a very key factor.
I deny that accusation. I go on record by saying he smells fine and always has.
I could play it back for
him. But they were asking.
Inoffensive. Inoffensive.
Downright pleasant. About the comic, like how we
use
that as a
job.
Yes, that's what we did.
What's been the unusual challenge as opposed to other projects you've worked on, or the thing you necessarily didn't see coming when you got into production that's been fun to kind of solve and find creative solutions for?
That's been fun?
Well, you can go either way.
I mean, for me, and I think this is the case for you, I mean, just things that have been different for us, and for me to direct, you know, I directed episodes of Veronica Mars and the movie Veronica Mars, but that didn't prepare me for the level of violence, blood, visual effects, and even as a writer, I've never, you know, people bashing brains in.
It's gross. That's usually the writer's room, not the actual.
Right. That's just if a script comes in. Like, yeah. But yeah, I feel like I've learned more about visual effects, you know, as sort of a character writer doing shows of people talking in rooms, and now suddenly, you know, we've got zombies and blood and shotguns and people in expensive zombie makeup. I don't know how they, like, we did our first, like, full-fledged, it's last week's episode, our Romero zombie. And, like, this is like a $20,000 hit to do that, like,
Friend in the Well?
Yeah, in the Friend in the Well.
And the Walking Dead, they actually kill people and make them zombies.
See, that seems so much...
That's cheaper?
Well, it seems cheaper.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
In Canada.
Yeah. And people are willing to do it. They're like, I just want to be on the show. Yeah. I'll die. It's okay. Daryl,
are we going to see why Well Zombie Friend is different than Blaine and...
Well, we can... we'll say that out loud. If Liv quit eating brains, that's what she would become. That, like, that is, Marcy was the cautionary tale. If Liv could not get her hands on brains, or if any of us, we want that specter, that fear for, you know, there, we don't know exactly how many, well, we know how many zombies are wandering around Seattle, but Liv doesn't, and if they quit eating, that is what they become, and the potential, not only for Liv to see her fate, but the potential for a zombie apocalypse, we wanted to put that in people's minds.
How soon will we find out how many zombies are actually out there?
You won't find out this season.
Oh, okay. Come on.
You will know there are more. You will meet more zombies.
But you won't have an exact head count.
Right. Okay.
But,
right.
And if Blaine is, I don't know if he's working for anybody else, or if he's on his own.
Well, this is one of those things that, in a way, we don't want to spoil. I mean, I can...
Does it matter? When it's David Andrews, do you care if there's someone else? Like, don't you just want to know... Like, you just want to be with Blaine anyway, so... Be there another person, maybe there's not one. I'm more interested in what he's doing. I would eat shit, Rob.
Without revealing anything, I mean, can you talk about what answers you want to give by the end of the season? What things you want to leave open for season two?
We will have a little bit step, come a little bit closer to understanding possibly what happened.
The trigger?
But yeah.
Yeah, I mean, things that we're gonna go down a path with Robbie developing the cure, that's going to happen. You're going to learn a lot more about Blaine's business model. In fact, you're going to be learning about Blaine's business model very soon. I would even be willing to tell you Blaine's business model if it doesn't come out in print before the audience is...
I'm like, I can guarantee it. Okay. I don't know these guys.
Wait, so we don't find out yet.
We find out.
In
4? 4 is such a thing. No, not in 4,
but in 5. I don't trust them. They look sketchy. You're the boss.
We'll whisper it.
You're the boss. I do whatever you say. You say jump. I say how high.
But we allude to it. I mean, with stuff that you kind of see in episode 2. Blaine has a business model. He finds wealthy people who can pay top dollar for brains, turns them into zombies, and then charges him for delivery. And he gets...
It's like creating drug addicts.
Yeah. And then selling them the product.
That's already here.
And then part of the question is, where is he getting those people? And he tends to try to get people who will not be missed. And those people, and you've seen a bit of this as well, tend to be the sort of people that Major works with in his job at a home for runaway teenagers. So everything builds towards showdown.
How tightly plotted is your big picture season, and how much do you leave room for yourselves to make discoveries and make zigs and zags along the way?
In both cases, you only asked about one case, but I would say this was true of Veronica Mars as well, is I think we have a really strong idea of how the season is going to end. In fact, the scenes that we ended the season with are the ones that I pitched to Robert Buckley when he was trying to decide. He was worried, am I just going to be the boyfriend?
Am I just going to be handsome? Yeah. Can't really tell a joke.
Do I get anything to do? And I pitched him what we thought how the season was going to end and what he was doing. And I would say that almost scene for scene, what I pitched him is in the show. So we have some of that. But like on Veronica Mars, we know where it's ending, and then the fun of getting there's a whole...
Don't listen to anything he says. Oh, man. I don't.
Wait. The difference between this and Veronica Mars was that with Veronica Mars we were on the air and we could hear fan reaction and kind of know what was working and what clues were steering people in certain directions, and like we could steer the ship a little bit. Like if people are thinking that the person who did it actually did it, we can move them away from that.
If the audience is liking that Logan fellow, perhaps we can show
maybe her. Maybe that's a good idea to develop. And we didn't have that advantage, but we did. You know, we discovered things in the show just from what we enjoyed watching and what we liked in dailies and studio and network liked. And I would say that over the course of the season, the episodes, I think, become less case-driven, less murder case of the week, that the zombie mythology is, like, the dessert becomes the main course, you know, that there's so much fun in the zombie mythology.
And in Liv's journey with that.
Yeah, and I'm not saying that we threw out the case of the week. I would just say that maybe 5 or 6 pages at the beginning of the season were in the case of the week, have now been shifted over into the zombie world, the zombie mythology.
So would you say that you have like a rough plan of where you would go with the future season?
Rough.
We actually have a really great plan up until episode 100. We have completely mapped out and are ready to go.
Robbie nails the camera. She's no longer a zombie. We just shut down production.
We shut down production. We each have a boat.
Has there been anything surprising about the fan reaction now that the show is out and you know everybody's talking about it?
I've been just blown. I hear it from, because I'm afraid of like social media except for Facebook, which I love, but Twitter scares the crap out of me. But I get it from Raul and Malcolm that it's just love, love, love.
Yeah,
and that's awesome.
It's been really nice. Yeah, I know that's such a bland answer to that question. But for the first, like, when we did Veronica Mars, there was Television Without Pity, but there was not, and I didn't dare kind of set foot in that.
I did get bad.
But this time there's Twitter, and I haven't had a show on the air while Twitter existed, and so I am wandering out, like on I'm tweeting.
Are they
on show nights? And it's been great. Yeah, I dig it. It's fun. It's been nice.
Along those lines, I actually have a little fan who's 9 years old. Her name's Leslie, and she wants to know: Do you think younger viewers should watch the show?
And my daughter wants to know why that 9-year-old gets to watch the show and she and the 10-year-old doesn't.
How are you up to late?
Is she a Nielsen fan?
I don't know.
In which case, she should really watch
it. It would help her with her education and keep her out of trouble.
My 10-year-old doesn't get to watch.
But Danielle stopped like...
One of our producers, she's got a 8 and a 12, and they both watch it. But they're LA kids. I have sweet Norman Rockwell, middle America kids.
Where's she from?
Pasadena.
Oh, yeah, she can watch.
She can look out her back door and see.
Something that I've heard being talked about with some of the other actors is that a lot of them don't really know where their characters are going or where the show's going. Is there a reason that you keep them in the dark, or are you still creating it, or...?
They're just trying not to answer your question.
Okay.
They know where their character is.
Yeah, like, I mean,
well,
Robert Buckley
like
knew, I mean, I told him exactly where we're going. I mean, I would say with Clive and Robbie, they're so integrated with the case of the week, we haven't given them sort of their own personal arcs and journeys I understand what they're saying and that they don't know exactly.
I also talked about when you said that you don't know what you're like the second season you ever planned up to there, but like how much do you have planned? Like where do you think see this going?
When we broke our final episode, we actually had to look at it as where do we land everyone for the beginning of season two. We had to understand what season two was going to look like before we could write the finale. We don't have I don't know as much about season two as I probably did going into season one, but the pilot process was so demanding of having your shit together on that. But we know roughly. The first 2 or 3 weeks in the writer's room is kind of spent talking about what is the big picture of the season. We tried to land them in juicy places that we were excited about launching them from. We've got key players in position, but there's still stuff to figure out.